Let's start. Hello and welcome to the presentation for Years of Thunder and how World Water Media went open source and what we learned in the past years. This is what we are going to do today. I will tell you a bit about the Thunder Core team. So who are we and what are we doing? And then we will look a bit back at the beginnings when Thunder started as a solution for our publishing house, World Water Media. I will then shortly explain how Thunder went open source. And then we will dive into the main part of the presentation today, and I will share 10 lessons we learned in the past years. And we will finish with a conclusion and a forecast. So that's the Thunder Core team. Let me introduce to you my colleagues. Well, start with myself, so you know who's speaking here. My name is Julia, and I am community manager and product owner of Thunder Distribution. So I am the non-technical part of the Thunder Core team, and for that I have my colleague Daniel Bosen with me here today, who is lead developer of Thunder, and he will gladly answer every technical question you might have. He is taking care of the live chat, and he's also here to answer all questions maybe you have in between or in the end. And we have in our team Christian Fitch and Volker Killesreiter, who are sitting together with Daniel and me here in Munich. And a part-time member of the Thunder Core team is Alex Pott. So let's have a look at the very beginnings, when Thunder started as a solution for World Water Media. For those of you who don't know, Hubert Water Media is one of the biggest publishing houses in Europe, and Water has around 600 media products worldwide. Thunder arose from the German Media Brands division, so we are seated in Munich. When you look at the brands we offer at Water, you can see that there are a lot of different brands, magazines, and also websites we publish. And all these magazine brands have their very unique and specific business models and audiences. So maintaining all these sites was becoming less and less efficient in the past years. And we were struggling with keeping the speed of innovation because we had to adapt faster and faster to everything. And at the same time, the resources were getting smaller and smaller. So we were looking for one solution for all these brands, but a solution which is flexible enough to meet all the different requirements of the several brands. So in 2018, 888, it was the very beginning of 888 then, but it was a perfect foundation for Thunder. It was free and open source. It was a modern content management system. It was widely used, well, not 888 at the moment, but Drupal in all. And we at Hubert Water Media had already made good experiences with Drupal. Plus, it is easily adaptable with thousands of modules. So this gives us the flexibility which we needed. So let's have a look at how we developed Thunder from Drupal. So this is a very simple simulation, but it gives you an impression how these things work. So when you look at Drupal Core and the modules you have there, we chose the ones that are fitting to our approach. And then we had to look at the content modules, but kind of the same way. There is a huge amount of content modules, and we selected those that fit best for the specific needs of a publishing house. When you look at all this setting and setup, we realized that there are some things missing, some features that a publishing house like ours needed. So we added some, well, called Thunder modules. These are basically contract modules like the others, but contract modules we designed from the very beginning. Looking at all these modules, we have to find a way to combine these. Set some configurations you need to find to test if everything works finally together. And this is also a big part of the work my colleagues are doing. And this whole setup, that's basically Thunder. Thunder is the base, the foundation for all our bots. So we have the centralized development of Thunder. The Thunder core team, my colleagues and I, are taking care of the distribution itself. So they're taking care that the foundation is always working. And then the brands themselves, they they adapt this base to their specific needs. So they add contrib modules, they write some new modules, they maybe change some configurations. They do whatever they need to do to fulfill their respective needs. So this was the approach we started with Thunder, a centralized development of the distribution and a decentralized adaption to the needs of the brands. By now, there are more than 30 websites at Border which have been migrated or launched on Thunder. This is a quick overview. It is for Border really a success story, as it became very easy to set up new sites, to launch new sites. So that's how it works. But how do we work, actually? What does the Thunder team do to maintain all this? There are basically four different aspects my colleagues are working on. So first, we're working on Drupal core, because that's the foundation for Thunder, as well as used contrib modules. So whenever we need something, something is not working fine, we try to correct all these in Drupal core or in the contrib modules. Then, of course, we have to take care of the adjustments we did, so that the core and the contrib modules harmonize optimally with each other. And then a part you should not forget is the testing. You should always try and test if the modules and contrib modules all work together, still work together. I will talk about this a bit later because it's an important point. So that's how it works for Border itself. So the next big step for us was going open source with all the setup. As you have seen, the Thunder core team has already been working in the open source ecosystem. So it was one small step for Thunder to become open source. Anyway, it was one giant leap for the publishing world itself, because going wholeheartedly for open source, that was something totally new in our industry. And Border has taken a pioneering role here. We still have to explain again and again why we are doing this and how it really works. Anyway, we felt at the very beginning that Border is, with all the different brands we have, a smaller representation of the publishing world. And so we are convinced that what works for us should work for other publishing companies too. And there were two points that convinced the management then in 2016 when Thunder went open source. On the one hand, we had nothing to lose. So we only invested the money we would have invested anyway. So that was fine, nothing to lose on this side. But on the other hand, there was a lot to win. For Border, going open source meant there are more users of Thunder. And the more people that work on Drupal core and the relevant contrib modules, the better gets the quality of the whole system. So the quality is improved and everyone gets more efficient. The more people that are working on the system, the faster you are. And by being fast and efficient, all save costs. And why should someone use Thunder as a starting point? Well, that's a no-brainer actually for our point of view, of course. The distribution is a good starting point. It is perfectly matched to the requirements of the publishing world, thanks to Border's expertise. It's a system that works fine, well, not fine, but very good for more than 30 Border brands. So it's not something that was developed just from someone who has no expertise in the industry, but from a big publishing house itself. Still, it's a super free and open source. What we gain from going open source, that's probably not new for you as you are working in this ecosystem. But what's important, message you can explain again and again, is that all Thunder users, whether they're the publishers themselves or the agencies, the commission, everyone works on the Drupal core and works on the Thunder specific contribute modules. And by selecting very certain modules and adding them to the distribution and working with them, the Thunder core team kind of influences which contribute modules are worked on. So all the users of the Thunder distribution are working on the modules we have chosen. So we kind of channelize the development work in here. So that's where we kind of bring everything together. This is a quick summing up what's the relationship between Drupal and Thunder, because that's something people, you cannot explain that often enough, to be honest. It's not, at least in the publishing world, it's not the easiest message to give. Basically, Drupal and Thunder, it's the same code. As I've explained before, you see that all the modules are the same. And Drupal is a general purpose CMS, so it's suited for large volume websites. Thunder, it's including the Drupal core, but also selected contribute modules and own what's redesigned by our own. And it's suited for late scale professional publishing. Both are open source under the GNU General Public License. And there's, of course, a code and documentation exchange. We select and adapt and configure the Drupal modules to include them in the Thunder distribution. And everything we do inside Thunder goes back to the Drupal modules. Okay, so this was a quick introduction to what Thunder is and where we come from. So now let's dive into the main part and look at what we have learned in the last past years. One big thing, you need to tell the story again and again, and you should never stop. Burda has already made positive experiences with the use of Drupal, but living open source wholeheartedly, using this centralized, decentralized approach where all departments work together and on the same basis, that was quite new to us. And this living open source, contributing back all the time and thinking about it all the time, that's a paradigm shift. And this should not be underestimated. It's really important. So we basically did what John Cotter, a pioneer of change management, summed up in his eight-step process for leading change. At the very beginning, it was all about creating a sense of urgency. So we pointed out the limitations of the old system and the advantages of Thunder to the management. Then we formed a coalition that was responsible. This is the Thunder core team, which who are the pioneers in our company, who are then going out like evangelists and promoting the idea to all the brands and everything. We did initiatives there as well. We did a roadshow or several roadshows at the several brands and promoting Thunder. We have regular meetings with all the product management, all the development teams. There were articles in the internet promoting Thunder and what we did. All this happened on a voluntary basis. So we didn't force anybody to launch his website or relaunch his website. If they had a running system, fine, don't touch it. But if you are thinking about a relaunch, then we strongly suggested using Thunder and promoting all the advantages you have. We helped with the launches. So the Thunder team went to the brands and helped the developers there to start with Thunder. And then we celebrated every relaunch. I can't believe we highlighted all the advantages. And then in these meetings, repeatedly pointed out why it was so easy this time and how good it was to take this path and everything. And basically, that's what we are still doing. This is where we stand. We still are in the middle of talking. We have to repeat all these adventures again and again because going open source is still a new approach in the publishing industry. So whenever there's some new person joining, you have to explain again why we are doing this and why we still believe it's a good idea to do this, and what are the advantages. And then this convincing again and again. Second, we cannot do everything, nor should we. That was a hard learning, and that's why we don't have a Thunder front end. People repeatedly ask for that, so I will explain to you today. When you do a distribution and you talk to a lot of editors and everything, there's the huge temptation now to do everything. Do it better, do it the right way, and do it right down to the last detail. But that's simply not possible. We don't have the capacity for it. See, our team is like 3.5 developers. but that's also not what we want to be. A distribution like Thunder is not a ready-made solution where you can just start with. It's a starting point where you need to continue. So actually, not too much should be specified. That's a bit of a danger. If you try to do too much, you lose others. So we rather have a perfect foundation for many than an inadequate complete solution for a few. And that is the story about the front-end theme. In the very beginning of Thunder, we had a front-end theme. If some of you was working with Thunder by then, they might remember the Infinity theme, which I was convinced, I'm still convinced it is a very nice theme, good idea, but it was way too special. It was not used very often, and there, because of this, caused a lot of problems when it came to updating and everything. You have to think of these and so many points. So we made a conscious decision to do without a front-end theme. It may not look great. So if you download Thunder, then you have like no front-end theme. So what can you say? It looks shitty. But that's actually what we want. We don't want to spend any work on the front-end, as we are convinced that a professional publisher will have his own front-end anyway. So this decision to not do special things allows us to concentrate on the essentials. This, of course, leads to the question, what are the essentials? For us, it's the editor. We focus on the on UX improvements because we want our editors to be heavy, to make their life easier. That's our goal. So we are working very close together with our editors. And that's one of the big advantages of Thunder, which comes from a publishing house. So our editors sit right next to us. The offices are very close. So we get ideas for new features from them, from their everyday editorial work. So for example, my colleague Christian is now working on the bulk edit function to give like 50 or 100 pictures in a gallery the same copyright, which is pain in the ass if you don't have it. But you need to know. So it's very good that we have these editors to talk to. When we started to work on the Thunder admin theme, we started not with working on the admin theme, basically, but with a survey of editors from different departments, asking them what is annoying them, what they wish for their daily life, and how we could help them. And these things then went in the development of the admin theme. During the development, we do multiple user acceptance tests again and again, showing our editors the first ideas and then let them test it, asking for their feedback. And so the development is very close to the everyday editorial work. So I would like to show you some examples from the Thunder admin theme that came from this survey I mentioned. So these are smaller points and big points, but everything makes life of the editors easier. So that was the functionality to add a paragraph. We are working with paragraphs, by the way, to add a paragraph exactly where you need it. Before that, you could only add it at the beginning or at the end, but not in between. So if you have long articles, if you do storytelling and have a lot of text and pictures and everything that was really making life easier for editors to add a new thing wherever they needed it. If you then have a lot of paragraphs and you have long reads, then it's quite good to sort paragraphs, not one by one, but to just sort multiple paragraphs in one step. Oh, that's another improvement. We ask if you really want to delete the paragraph. That's again, if you work with a lot of paragraphs and it's a bit busy, this might happen by accident. So we added this question between deleting and really removing a paragraph. As you see, there's no sidebar here. There it is. You can hide the sidebar if you want to focus on the content of your article. And last but not least, it's a static bar for the action buttons. As you see at the bottom, the Save As button and all the other buttons, they don't move when my colleague is scrolling here. Well, that's the point. Before that, you had to scroll down to the very end of the article to save the article. That was especially disturbing when you just changed a bit in the headline and then had to scroll down several paragraphs to save that change. Coming to the fourth point, we now learned that what we as a standard team don't want to do. We learned what we want to focus on. So this leads us to the how we are doing this and how to decide on the way to go. A lot depends basically on the decision how the required features are implemented. So this is how we do this. We ask ourselves at the very beginning, is there a core module? If so, and if it fits mostly our requirements, then we go for it. So that's first choice ever, go for Drupal core. If no, we check if there's a contrib module. Then we ask ourselves, does it mostly fit our requirements or can we make it fit? If so, and if it is used and maintained and continuously developed so everything looks quite fine, we go for it. So that's second best solution. Only if this is not possible. So if there is no content module or if it's really not possible to adapt it, then we go for some own solution, some configuration solution, some adaption, some custom solution. But mostly we will try then to write a contrib module on our own. There are 8 contrib modules we did ourselves because there was nothing we could use, but we tried to solve everything in modules and contrib modules and best way in core. And that's the next lesson we learned. Staying close to the center is the best idea you can have. There are some, of course, disadvantages, and people may object that the closer you work to the core, the more complex is the work. There are many things not yet optimal. There are many people who want to have a say. Things are discussed at length and in detail, and to sum it up, all things take a lot of time. But we also see that you get a lot of support from the community. And we are convinced that any common solution is better than a local patch do. By going for an open and a common solution, you get ongoing feedback and support from people using the module. And by this, Drupal community improves the quality of your module, which makes your solution more stable and future-proof. So we think that these benefits are more important than the complex work. And we can recommend to just invest in a core committer to overcome these obstacles. So core committers are making core better, though that itself is that's the best reason to invest in those people. Thank you very much to all core committers. You are doing a great job. They have a lot of knowledge and experience, and they can contribute this to the discussions and by thus help you find the optimal solution for each problem, for your specific problem. And yeah, but that's welcome, Alex Pott. He's a part-time Thunder core team member since 2017 and has joined a lot of discussions and helped us. And well, I think one of the best decisions ever to get him on board. When it comes to maintaining a distribution like Thunder, it's all about testing. If you remember the picture of what Thunder is and you see this whole bunch of modules, yep, there are core modules, content modules, our modules, some external stuff, and we need to keep the business running somehow. So we needed to find out a way to check all this, but with reasonable effort, because we have to do it like every day. If you have a bunch of modules, something is changing every time. Something, some small changes that can, well, kind of blast the whole thing. So we do several types of tests on a regular basis. So there are, of course, integration tests, and we check if everything is working together. We test if you can update from an old Thunder version to the most current version regularly. And we have visual regression tests to check if every button is there where it has to be. Daniel just offered to tell a lot more about the technical part of this. Maybe he can do it in the end if someone's interested. So he's the person to ask for details on that topic.
Maybe you can still interrupt a bit, because sure. We have two questions regarding the theme that you just showed, the admin theme. Mm-hmm. The questions were if we were working on or if we were evaluating the Gin admin theme for future versions of Thunder, and yes, we do. We are evaluating Gin and, of course, Claro. So this is actually one of the biggest things that we are currently working on. And the other one was if the admin theme that you just showed was available outside of the distribution. And of course, it is. It's on Drupal.org. Thunder admin is the project name. Just because.
Thank you very much. Okay. Additionally to these regular tests, we also test future Drupal versions whenever they are available. That's what I said before. We want to stay very close to the core, and of course, we want to stay up to date. So we also include future Drupal versions in our testing. We learned now that the whole system needs to be very flexible, and at the same time, we kind of need to maintain everything. So one way to offer specific features without being too close are optimal modules. Optimal modules are modules that are relatively special. They are probably only needed by a small group of users, but a group of users that is very important for us, because Thunder is for professional publishing, so we have a very specific target group. So we are walking a very narrow path of, on the one hand, offering such special features on the one hand, but also not wanting to make too many default settings for people who may not want them. So our solution are modules that can be easily switched on and off within Thunder. That looks like this. So for example, this is Thunder EVW. EVW is a German information community for the assessment of the circulation of media. So those are tracking how many people are on the websites. It's a Thunder Live Blog module. If you want that as a news magazine, you want to report live about events that might be interesting for you. But if you don't do this, there's no sense in adding this module. But these are the list of the modules, and you can easily click if you want them or unclick if you don't want them. And we even get this a bit wider. By now you can even switch between multiple implementations. That was necessary with the module search API because there is more to this module than just the module itself. With this API, you then also have a very specific content list. You only need this content list if you have Search API activated, and if not, you don't need it. So it's not just one module you need to activate or deactivate, but it's a whole different implementation. So we also did this in this year with the launch of the Search API module. Now you get a bit of an impression of the challenges that you have to be flexibility, but also helping people. And that is all summed up when it comes to updates. The big question is how to update this distribution that someone has already customized for themselves. So that is really a big question. It was a big question for us. So you have normal code updates and you they run through Composer. So we don't have much to do with that. Check. But Thunder also provides fully configured features that include code and configurations, and both need to be updated. So sometimes additional changes to configurations are necessary, and Drupal itself doesn't offer that. It's a relatively complex issue, I was told. And for this, my colleagues have written the update helper, which makes it possible to update configurations that are exactly as we ship them. And that's important, only then. So we only touch what the user of the distribution has not changed himself. So there's a check, and if there have been any changes, we won't update this module, but also give a notification that remembers you, hey, there was an update, you might want to look at this. The update helper looks like this, and I think it's also used in other distributions.
Can you hear me? We have a question to the to that updating, which was how quickly do you update modules and core when security updates appear? And I think that's an interesting question. And in the previous slide, if you go back one slide, you can see it's mostly done in the first part. It's we get them by Composer. So we do not really update the distribution if Drupal has a security update, because you just do your Composer update. We don't deliver the whole source code. We deliver the Composer file. So if you do the Composer update, you get the updates. Sometimes we have locked versions of Drupal core or some modules to a specific version. Then we would need to do an update. And we try to do that as quickly as possible, of course. But in general, you should be fine with Composer update, and you don't need to do it at all. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Okay. What we realized very soon was that we cannot do all these things on our very own. And we learned that quite early. When we get the first feedback from other publishing houses, and they really liked the idea of Thunder, getting an open source system for free, which is, hand-built for publishers, perfect. And they came to us and asked, well, can you do that for us? And we just have to say them, no, because we are a publishing house too and no IT company. We cannot build that for you. So we got those on board who are the experts of the job. Well, the Drupal experts, kind of you, everybody who's listening here, we need to help. And we introduced the Program 35 Thunder Integrator. So a CTI is anybody who helps publishers or any other company implement Thunder. Anybody can become a CTI. It's an consultancy, a developer, an agency, anybody who realizes Thunder projects and delivers good code quality. We check this. So there's no money involved in this program, but it's a system of recommendations. So you have to convince us that you are doing a good job, and then we recommend you to other publishers or to whoever who ask us to about someone who can help him implement Thunder projects. We are convinced that in this ecosystem, everyone wins because, the agencies who are CTIs, they get new customers. The customers find someone who realizes their Thunder projects, and well, we all win from more Thunder users. The whole Thunder community, Drupal, everyone. So from our point of view, it's a great system. And by now, there are 21 certified Thunder integrators worldwide. These are our partners. Huge thanks to all of them. It's really great to work together with them. When it comes to working together, that last but not least, we want to keep chatting with everyone. So we want to foster an exchange of ideas and experiences. That's really important for us, like really living open source. So what we do are several things. We do workshops with our certified Thunder integrators on special topics. For example, the last one was about headless approaches or API first approaches, just exchanging what was everyone doing and what were the advantages and disadvantages of this or that concept. So very interesting and I hope beneficial for everyone who participated. We support Drupal events such as DrupalCon, Drupal camps, Splash Awards, whatever that comes up. I hope there will be more next year. We also started our very own Thunder Day in 2017, especially for the publishing world, to bring the whole idea of open source into traditional businesses like publishing houses. And we are promoting collaboration and open source thinking whenever we talk about Thunder. So it's a bit of a door opener to start talking to other publishing houses, and we promote the idea of working together every time we can. Okay, that's what we have learned. And looking now back on 4 years of working with Thunder and working with open source, we learned that open source is not necessarily the quickest way to do things, but we are convinced it's the right way. Because if you do it properly, and that's what we are trying to do, an ecosystem evolves in which elements work together like gears, and everything keeps running and everyone benefits. So that's a very important point. It's open source is not for daydreamers and altruists, but it's a big business. And as that, it's a perfect solution for a modern tech and media company like Hubert Boda Media. So we are more determined than ever to contribute to Drupal. And that leads to a really short forecast, what we are working on in the near future, or the big issues. This is Claro and Jin, as Daniel has already pointed out. We want to make these themes also fitting the editor's needs as best as possible, as good as possible. We are looking into API first approaches and want to find a way to support websites using API first best way possible. And of course, we have then to look into Drupal 10 and prepare everything for that. Okay, and I think I'm on time. Thank you all very much. I hope we have some time for questions if there are one. But for the moment, thank you very much.
Yeah, we have a few questions. We have the question, is this platform with Parkinson DE created from scratch or based on installation profile? I'm not sure. I don't know about the Parkinson DE website, but Thunder is created from, is the installation profile made from scratch?
I also don't know this website. As an open source project, we don't know if someone is using Thunder or not, except they tell us. So if you use it, please tell us.
The other question was, have you a plan to upgrade to Drupal 9, and how is it planned with the client? We already did. We have two versions of Thunder. One is compatible with Drupal 8, and the other one is only compatible with Drupal 9. And what we did there was help all our dependencies to be Drupal 9 compatible as far as we could. And once that was reached, we basically were Drupal 9 compatible. And the client has to, whatever it takes from Thunder, it is already Drupal 9 compatible if he has custom code or other contrib modules that are still Drupal 8, then he has to fix those or maybe we will have that module in the future, and then we will try to do that as well. What tools did you use for project management? I'm not sure. No, no tools. Jira.
Jira, yeah, Confluence.
GitHub, stuff like that.
Very small team of four people plus Alex sitting in one office, so it's a lot of just chatting.
Then it's an interesting question. If you could change any decision you've made in the last 4 years, what would it be?
If from my point of view as a community manager, I would chat, I would have loved to chat even more about everything. Because whenever you talk about distribution, you convince someone to go for open source, and that's the best win you can get. The more people are working on it, the better it gets.
Yeah, for me, I would say it's already said in the slides. It was the decision that I made that we should include a front end theme, and that was not a good idea. That was work that we could not actually do. So that's my one. Is there scope to collaborate between distributions for learning and sharing best practices? We try to do that on DrupalCons. and on each DrupalCon, there is some kind of session or BOF where we sit together with other distribution maintenance. But otherwise, we are very, 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 very open to all this kind of work, and we really like to work with other distributions. They are not our competitors in any way or something. And yes, please. So, I think let's check the questions. Looks like that's it.
Great. And on time.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you all. And we are here these days, so we'd love to chat about Thunder. As I said, so feel free to write, address any of the Thunder core team.
Goodbye.
Okay, thank you very much. Goodbye.